بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه الطيبين الطاهرين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين بسم الإله وبه بدينا ولو عبدنا غيره شقينا وحبذا ربا وحب دينا وحبذا محمد هادينا أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يرزقني وإياكم الإخلاص في النية والقول والعمل. All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise the rank of our master Muhammad and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I remind myself and you to intend in your heart that you are here today for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll continue today, inshallah, where we started last week with the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we started with the first attribute, after we went through a bit of explanation about the meaning of the Shahada al-Ula, the first testification of faith, La ilaha illallah, no one is God except Allah, no one deserves to be worshipped except Allah. And we went more into details about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He does not resemble us, that He does not need us. And then we started to explain the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first attribute we explained was existence, al-wujud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, afillahi shak, which means there's no doubt in the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no doubt, because this alam is alama, dalil, an evidence of the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah exists without a place. Allah existed eternally and nothing else existed. Yani clear, the sound mind accept that. So Allah exists, no beginning, without a beginning, without an end. Allah exists without a beginning, without an end. He exists without a place. Allah Ta'ala is not in the sky. Allah Ta'ala is not above His throne. Allah Ta'ala is not sitting or established on the throne. This is not the Aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This is the Aqeedah of Mushabbiha Mujassima, those who resemble Allah to the creation. They call themselves Muslims and they say, Allah is a body but we don't know how. They say Allah Ta'ala is in the sky, and the evidence, ayahs in the Quran, they use it out of context. And they say, when we make dua, we do, oh Allah. Yeah, we make dua when we put our hands to the sky, not because Allah Ta'ala is in it, but because the sama, the sky, is the direction of the supplication. The sama, the sky, qiblatul dua, the direction of the supplication. I'll give you an example. This is what? Mihrab. When I pray and face this way, does that mean Allah Ta'ala this way? No. But I'm facing this way because this is the Qibla of the Muslims. When I pray, I need to direct my chest towards the Qibla, towards Mecca, the Kaaba. Not because Allah Ta'ala is in the Kaaba. So we have to be very careful. The second one, oneness. Al-Wahdaniyya. There's only one God. Can't be two gods, can't be three gods. Only one God who deserves to be worshipped. If someone is worshipping something other than Allah, something other than God, and himself he call it God, it doesn't mean what he's worshipping is God. It doesn't mean what he is worshipping is God. The only one who deserves to be worshipped is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then eternity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is eternal, without a beginning. Allah ta'ala has no beginning, as we explained. And everlastingness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everlasting. So the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not come to an end. I will come to an end. I will die. I have a beginning and I have an end. Doesn't matter how long I live. I might live for 100 years. I might live for 200 years. Allahu a'lam. Allah knows how long I will live. But definitely I will die. Definitely I will die. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no beginning and has no end. So everlastingness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exists without a beginning and does not come to an end. This world will perish one day. This world will perish. There will be a day of judgment and all this world will be gone. And people will be resurrected and assembled on the Ard al-Mubaddala, Ard al-Mahshar. So we have to understand that Allah Ta'ala has no beginning and Allah Ta'ala has no end. Also, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is attributed with the sifat non-needness of others. Non-needness of others. I will need you and you will need me, because we are both what? Creation. Imagine, brother, my car is not working. And I've got maybe, let's say I've got a four-wheel drive, big one. And I need to push it, you know, the Lebanese way. One will sit in the car and five, six people will be pushing. And then he will try to start the car. Allah, here you got RACV or something like that? No. In Lebanon we have PWF. You know what's that? Push with your friends. So I will need my friends to come and give a push to the car, and myself I will sit in the car and start it when it's the time. If I need to carry something heavy, I need you to help me. So we are in need of others, and others are in need of us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not need us. We all need Allah. We all need Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The bird in the sky needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The humans, the animals, the trees, everyone needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah ta'ala does not need us. So Allah ta'ala is attributed with non-needness of others. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed with power, qudra. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed with power. And his power is over everything. His power is over everything. Yani those kids when they watch Batman, or Superman, or Spider-Man, or Lollyman, or Ant-Man, or أعوذ بالله. شو هذا؟ قال he can fly, he can whatever it is, and this, you have to be careful about these movies as well. You know, teach your kids how to have a role model, the companions, the prophets, the messengers, the awliyaullah, the ulama, not something, you know, not real, not those unreal things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed with power, and His power is over everything. His power is over everything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the arsh. What did Imam Ali radiallahu anhu said? Imam Ali said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَ الْعَرْشَ إِظْهَارًا لِقُدْرَتِهِ وَلَمْ يَتَّخِذْهُ مَكَانًا لِذَاتِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَ الْعَرْشَ إِظْهَارًا لِقُدْرَتِهِ وَلَمْ يَتَّخِذْهُ مَكَانًا لِذَاتِهِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the arsh as a sign of His power, not to take it a place for Himself. Who said this? Imam Ali, the most knowledgeable of the companions. And those people, they say Allah Ta'ala is above the throne, but we don't know Him. They say Allah Ta'ala is sitting on the throne, وَلَعِيَّاذُ بِاللَّهِ, and this is against the Aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributed with will. Everything that occurs in this world is by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for you to come late, by the will of Allah. Everything happens by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah willed for you to do something, you will do it. No one can stop you. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed for you not to go somewhere, you won't go. And we've seen this. I'm pretty sure each and every one of you have seen something, witnessed something, either himself or for others. I intend to go Singapore. I booked my ticket, then lockdown happened, border closed, I couldn't go to Singapore. I wanted to go to Pakistan, booked my ticket, something happened, border closed. I went to Pakistan at the airport, they checked my name, said, you're not allowed to come in. Why? That's it, we feel like it, we never know. It happens. So, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ كَانْ وَمَا لَمْ يَشَأْ لَمْ يَكُنْ Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed for it to be, shall be, and whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed for it not to be, shall not be. مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ كَانْ وَمَا لَمْ يَشَأْ لَمْ يَكُنْ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed with knowledge. Al-ilm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about all things before they occur. عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ وَالشَّهَادَةِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. Everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what happened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's happening. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's going to happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is not going to happen. If it was going to happen, how it will happen. لا يعلم الغيب إلا الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who knows the unforeseen, الغيب. لا يعلم الغيب إلا الله سبحانه وتعالى. So Allah ta'ala is attributed with knowledge. But His knowledge is not like my knowledge and your knowledge. Your knowledge was preceded by what? Ignorance. You were born, you don't even know how to get up, how to walk, how to talk, how to eat. You didn't even know that. Then you gained the knowledge about how I eat and how I walk. And how many times your mom and dad, one dad will be on this couch, the mom will be on this couch, 1 meter away from each other, and you'll be in the middle. They will try to let you go to walk to your dad. So sometimes you will fall, sometimes you'll do 2 steps, sometimes you'll do 1 step, then 2 steps, 3 steps, 5 steps, and mashallah, you become a runner. You learned how to walk. So when you go to reception, here you call it in Adelaide reception, in Sydney Kindy, in Melbourne Prep, you know, and now National Curriculum Foundation, you know, different names. You start to go, you go to childcare, you go to kindy, you go to grade 1, 2, 3, etc. And you go, you learn. So your knowledge is gained. And sometimes you learn something, then you totally forget about it. Sometimes you learn something, and then you totally forget about it. Yani how many times you're talking to your friend, to your brother, and then you tell him, Subhanallah, I was going to ask you a question, but I forgot. Or you tell him, have you been to that shop? Which shop? Subhanallah, this one on the corner. You know, I just forgot it. So your knowledge increase and decrease. But the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it wasn't preceded by ignorance. The knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almullahi azaliyun abadi. Almullah azali abadi. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed with hearing, as-sam'a. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is all what is hearable without an ear or any other organ. Without an ear or any other organ. I can hear you and you can hear me with our ears. And maybe later on my hearing will be affected by sickness, then I need to have hearing aid. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears all the hearable things without an ala, without an organ, without an organ or anything else. But where our hearing, sometimes you can hear properly, sometimes you don't. Sometimes someone talking to you and they say, come again, sorry, come again. What do you mean? I didn't hear you. Can you repeat that phrase? Can you repeat that sentence? Why? Because we are creations. And that's a great evidence that we cannot be gods and a person can't be gods. Some people, they say, God is in us. They say, God is in us. They say, everyone in us has God. In him, wal'iyadu billah. Or they say, this world is Allah. And this is against the religion of Islam. This is against Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, regardless what they call themselves. Not everyone call himself Sunni, he's a Sunni. Not everyone call himself, I follow the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That means he's a follower of the companions. You have to check their Aqidah. You have to check their Aqidah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is attributed with sight. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says all what is seeable without a pupil or any other organ. Yani, huh? I can see you like this, but not clear. Then I will use my glasses. Some people, they might use contact lenses to see. Some people, if they want to look from at far things, they use what? The microscope. They will look, you know, to make sure that they can see something from far. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have an eye or hadaqa or any alas to for him to see us. Allah Ta'ala knows about us. Allah Ta'ala knows about our movements. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala knows about our hearts, what is in our hearts, if we are sincere or if we are not. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Also Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is attributed with life. The life of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is not like our life. Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. Al-hayy. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is attributed with life, al-hayat. But His life not like our life. Your life is a combination of blood, flesh, bones, etc. But the life of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is not like our life. The life of Allah is azaliyya, abadiyya. My life has a beginning and has an end. Is it clear? Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is also attributed with al-kalam, sifat al-kalam, speech. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, Allah's speech is without a tongue or lip. His speech is not in any language. When I talk in English. I'm talking in English now. Sometimes I talk in Arabic. Sometimes I have to talk to some brothers in Urdu. Sometimes I have to talk in French. Sometimes I have to talk in Indonesian. Sometimes I have to talk in African. So when I speak any language, when I speak any of these languages, they all sign of me being creation. Allah's kalam, kalamullah, is not Arabic, is not English. Kalamullahi laysa ka kalamina. The kalam of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is not like our kalam. Is not like our kalam. Our kalam is with the language, with the sound, with order. When I say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, I say Ba, then Sin, then Mim, then Alif, Lam, Lam, Ha, Alif, Lam, Ra, Ha, Mim, Noon, Alif, Lam, Ra, Ha, Ya, Mim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. The kalam of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is not like our kalam. His kalam does not resemble our kalam. وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. So here an ayah to prove that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is attributed with kalam. And kalamullah is azali abadi. All His attributes are azaliyya abadiyya. Also Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala attributed with a non-resemblance to the creation. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is attributed with non-resemblance to the creation. What does it mean? Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala in any way. What did we say last week? Do you remember those sayings? مهما تصورت ببالك فالله لا يشبه ذلك. مهما تصورت ببالك فالله بخلاف ذلك. We cannot imagine Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala does not resemble His creation. ليس كمثله شيء. Allah does not resemble the creation. This is the Aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Allah does not resemble the creation. So we can't say Allah Ta'ala is a body but not like our bodies. We can't say Allah Ta'ala is above the throne in a direction but we don't know how. This is not the Aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. A lot of people, they use the ayahs of the Quran and they put it out of context. And they tell you Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, and they use the ayahs But if you look at the ulama al-tafsir, they said against what they're saying. And we've explained about Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa linguistically. I explained to you about from a linguist perspective, and what the ulama also said of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So there's, you don't look and you don't listen to others who go against Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. You don't go and listen to those who are against Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, because those people, they couldn't accept the idea of that Allah Ta'ala cannot be imagined. They couldn't accept the idea that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala cannot be imagined. So there are 13 attributes: Al-Wujud, Al-Wahdaniyya, existence, oneness, eternity, everlastingness, non-needness of others, power, will, hearing, sight, knowledge, life, speech, and non-resemblance to the creations. They are 13 attributes of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, which I highly encourage each and every one of you to memorize them with the definition of the meaning in one line, and motivate your kids to memorize them as well. Why? Because when you memorize them, they will stay in your mind. And then the more you repeat them, the more you understand. The more you have this aqidah in your heart and head and in your life. And then after that, it won't be easy for someone to brainwash you, as they say, or misguide you in a way. By the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you be sincere and you hold on the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, because this is your success. My brothers and sisters, wallahi, we are in a very hard time. Very, very hard time. Yani the fitan, the seditions are widespread. People, a lot of them, they don't want to listen. People who are misguiding others using money, power, positions, businesses. And subhanAllah, when you come and advise someone, you tell him, brother, what are you doing? This is wrong, this is haram. Or you go to another person and tell him, hey, this is not the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. What are you doing to yourself? I love goodness for you, I want to be with you in Al-Jannah. You provide him with the evidence, you provide him with the ayah, with the tafsir of the ayah, you provide him with the hadith, you provide him with the source, you provide him with the saying of the all ulama. But subhanAllah, he will say, no, my shaykh said this. Or no, this is not right, wal'iyadu billah. He will go against anything just to what? To please his nafs, to fulfill his need, because he will be comfortable by this. But on the day of judgment, will he be comfortable? No. On the day of judgment, he will be asked and he will be judged. And if he died on this aqidah, he will not be among Ahlul Jannah. He will not be among Ahlul Jannah. So we are in a very hard time. And subhanAllah, you find people who have the aqidah of tashbih and tashseem, they resemble Allah Ta'ala to the creation. And then you find other people who are against them, but at the same time, they play it politically and they say, look, okay, they're still ulama, they're still scholars, we still respect their view, but this is not the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. How can you do that? People within your skin, they're calling themselves Sunnis and they're calling themselves Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and they're encouraging your kids to do something bad and to kill others and to do this and that. It's your duty, it's your obligation to make sure that your son is learning the aqidah. Not about only your son. Do you need an iPad? Do you need a phone? Are you okay? Do you want me to buy you a car? Do you want a house? Do you want food? A lot of parents, they think being a good parent only to provide food and good clothes and brands to their kids and provide them with what they like. But then when it comes to the religion, slowly, brother. Slowly, I'm taking it easy. You know, you have to be very wise. You don't go too hard on them. I'm not asking you to go too hard on them. I'm just asking you to yourself get up from this couch, turn this Netflix off, take your kids to the mosque, sit down 1 hour per week, learn, and then take them back. Is that pushing your kids too hard? When you tell him, come to the lesson, subhanallah, brother, wallahi, yani, if you told me 2 days ago, I would have changed what I have to do. But I was invited, and subhanallah, you know, ayatul munafiqi thalath. Iza wa'ada akhlaf. You know, straight away they used the hadith that to suit the case. I gave them a promise that I will come. But if I tell him, brother, what are you doing in 2 hours? Not tomorrow, not tonight. What are you doing in 2 hours? Why, brother, tell me. Wallahi, we're going for a picnic. And we have some barbecue. Would you like to join? Yeah, of course. Look, I was invited to someone. Can I bring them with me? You know? And he will come. Why? Because something suits him. Something he's interested in. He will find time. But when you tell him something about his religion, something about his akhirah, the hereafter, Iblis will give him excuses and excuses and excuses, and then he will end up what? In the grave, and he will be feeling, regretting every moment that he was able to go and learn and he didn't learn. You have 168 hours per week. Do your prayers at least. Obligatory prayers, 5 prayers. They will take maybe 25 to 30 minutes, all of them. If you do it like wudu and salat, you do the obligations. Start with that. And say to yourself, okay, I've got every Saturday a lesson at the mosque. Whatever is happening, I will go to the mosque, insha'Allah ta'ala, and this is my priority. So you already gave 3.5 hours per week for your prayers. And you gave 1 hour to start with for attending a lesson. 4.5 hours. Let's say, Akhi, 5 hours. You still have 163. Go, jump on the trampoline on it for 163 hours. It's up to you. Don't tell me in 163 hours per week you can't do a lot of things. You can work 60 hours per week. You can sleep 12 hours per day from this 163. You can have another 8 hours free time. And you will still have extra time. And if you work 60 hours, usually the rate is what? 40 hours. So you work 60 hours, yani 7 days a week, plus few hours over time, yani you'll be making a lot of money, mate. True? Tayyib, when it comes to this 4 hours, yani which I'm asking, your obligation, salawat, you have to. Don't come and tell me, I made 3.5 hours for you, brother. You're not making it for me, I'm not making it for you. You're doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is an obligation on you to pray. Don't go to people and say, the Shaykh asked me to free 3.5 hours, so I owe him. You know? He owes me. You know? I did him a favor. No, you did yourself a favor. So this time, try as much as you can to stick with the circle of knowledge, majalis al-ilm. Sit with people you trust, those who learned the religion from trustworthy people, and with the right aqidah, who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who, if you ask them and they don't know, what do they say? I don't know. Because some people, you ask them, and he doesn't want to say, I don't know, because why? Ah, if I say, I don't know, I will lose the presence of a sheikh. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا. If you don't know, you say, I don't know. I will ask for you. I will ask my Shaykh, who is more knowledgeable than me. Don't give an answer just for you to look, ah, mashallah, he's very knowledgeable. You will be asked on the Day of Judgment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us, to bless us, and to make us among those who have the right belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us al-jannah without any prior punishment. Allahumma ameen, ya rabbal alameen, nuhallil thalath marrat, wa nusalli ala nabiyyi Muhammad thalath marrat. La ilaha illallah.